Welcome everybody to the Tone Church. We have a pretty exciting episode for you today. We are going to be building a clone of a Boss Dimension Chorus pedal. Pretty exciting stuff there. And what we're going to be using for a board, circuit board, is this Aion FX Blueshift Chorus project that we got here. So if you've never built an effects pedal before, this is not the one for you. That's for damn sure. As you can see here, this has two circuit boards, and they stack on top of each other and connect to each other, and it gets jammed into a teeny tiny little enclosure. So there's lots of pitfalls if you don't order components with the right size and footprint. You're going to have a problem if you don't get everything to line up and get the header pins to line up and solder them correctly. That's going to cause a problem. It's an extremely complicated circuit with archaic bucket brigade chips, and if you screw that up, you're going to have a problem. So this is not for beginners. It's probably not even for me, but we're going to try it anyway. What's so good about the Dimension Chorus? A normal chorus is a delay effect, and what happens is it takes your regular signal and then it splits it into two, and so you have two signals, and then using a low frequency oscillator, it delays one of the signals back and forth like this, very slightly. And with normal chorus effects, you get that pulsating sound. With the Dimension Chorus, what I believe happens is it splits your signal into three. You got your dry and then two other ones, which are 180 degrees apart. So they're when one wave is up, the other wave is down, and they cancel each other out, sort of. The waviness cancels out. And so what you end up with is just a nice, shimmery thing. Insert your own adjectives and nouns there. Nice, shimmery sound. That is unlike any other chorus effect pedal, and it's pretty awesome. This is a very expensive project. Looks like the components I got from Mouser are $58 plus shipping. I needed to get some other parts that Mouser didn't have because they're archaic. And that looks like it cost another $30. So now we're up to 90. We need an enclosure, so that's 105. Solder, wire, three-pole, double-throw, jacks, DC, whatever. Well, you'll like it $120 for this sucker. You can go on to Reverb or other sites and get a used Boss Wazacraft for like $170. And I think a brand new one costs $200. So, given the chances, if you're not too good with putting together these pedals, taking a chance spending all that money on something that might not work, it might be worth it if you want this effect to just go buy the real deal Wazacraft. But if you like a challenge, there you go. If you want to step it up, you've built a few pedals and you're ready for something a little more exciting, this might be the one for you. All right, let's find out if this is the one for me. Let's try and put this sucker together. All right, here we go. Stay tuned.
Magazine, too many cameras and not enough food. This is what we've seen, driven to tears.
Alright folks, now we're getting down to brass tacks here. We have all of the components installed into the boards, like so. We have not yet socketed the integrated circuits. It's been quite a slog, I tell you what. If you're undertaking this project yourself, I recommend make sure you get out the old isopropyl 99% alcohol and clean off the flux residue. Even if you're using the no clean stuff, a lot of these components are tightly packed together, and if you don't clean the flux off, it makes it difficult to see if you made any solder bridges, which I did at least twice. So we found those and we cleaned them up. But we have all the resistors, capacitors, diodes, and these guys, what are these things called? Transistors. And sockets installed. And we are very carefully following the build instructions, assembly instructions. We use the drill template. All right. We haven't cut this to full size yet. We're probably going to use a socket for the indicator LED. I think there will be enough room. But anyway, we have temporarily installed our three input and output jacks. And this guy here is a stereo TRS jack. These two are mono. We have our standoff here. And we use the, I believe there's a build sheet, a bill of materials that goes directly to Mouser, like a spreadsheet. If I recall correctly, we use that to order order all this stuff. Some of the stuff was out of stock, so we have some substitutions here. But anyway, we installed the first of three Carling switches here. And what they tell us to do is, again, if you buy all the stuff that they tell you to buy, you will get a package with some extra hex nuts. Your Carling switches, and they tell us to put three of these suckers on here snugly, which we are doing. Here we go. And they say to use three because this will be the correct height. The it's very important the how the boards line up in the Z-axis inside the enclosure. And since they are standing on the switches and the standoff, it's important that the switches are connected to the enclosure at the correct height. I do not use these whenever possible, whenever I can find washers in stock. I don't use these washers that come with the switches. I use these, I buy these little guys here as a replacement, and they're thinner and smaller. The build instructions don't mention anything about using the lock washer, but I believe I'm going to use the lock washer. I believe we'll be able to get the top nut on there and be able to thread it enough times so it'll work. if you're using that included washer that has the key on it that fits into the slot of the shaft of the switch, probably won't be able to use the little lock washer, tooth washer on the other side here. Probably won't be enough space, and there still might not be enough space even with this guy here. I'm finding it difficult. Well, we've done it once, why can't we do it again? Maybe if we make these guys a little snugger. Snug them up. Yeah, that's pretty snug. Let's try again. All right, get the sucker on you. I need another hand. There we go. Gotta squeeze it down. It's a tight fit with those little washers there. And we'll thread this guy on there. Use a tool to help us out. There we go. There we go. Yeah. I'm gonna crank it down because we might need to twist it a little bit. That guy's in the wrong spot, I guarantee it. Oh no, we get locked out. Or did we? Nope. We screwed up. He's on the wrong side. Anyway, I'm going to put this guy in the right hole and put the third switch in, which is supposed to be single pole. So I'm going to dig one of those up, and then I'll catch back up with you once I've done that. Hang tight. All right, we found our single pole, double throw on switch. And I highly recommend that you buy Carling or Gorva or Tiway toggle switches for your projects. Do not get the generic ones. I know these suckers are expensive. These are like $4.69 each. But I have noticed I've had lots of problems with the generic ones. Never had a problem with Carling or Gorva or Tiway, but I know of at least two problems I've had with the generic ones, the no-name ones. They look exactly the same as this, except it doesn't say Carling on it. But they're kind of junk, in my experience. Your mileage may vary, but we don't get a lot of mileage around here. All right, there we go. We have our switches temporarily installed here. Now we have two boards. We have not put the jumpers on yet that are going to connect these two boards. We're just going to try and get the feel for this. Now, it's a little confusing when you're first approaching the project. You're not sure how things are supposed to go. This little board here, I think they call this the clock board. Obviously, these jumpers are for the switches, so we know that this needs to go in here like this or like this. And we have these two trimmers on this side, and the silk screen for the trimmers was also on this side, so that's how we know which side this goes on. We will be able to access those through holes through this bigger board here, so we know these need to face what I guess is technically the bottom of the enclosure. So we can be sure that this goes here like this, and it looks like everything is lining up. Is that correct? Did we do a good thing here? Oh yeah, there we go. On the other side, we have I don't know what that's called here. It's flat on top, and it's got the chamfered edges on the other side. So we used a countersink to make a countersunk hole for that to flatten that out a little bit. So that's going to go like that. That looks good there. So we need to add 1, 2, 3, 4. Is that correct? 4 sets of jumpers to connect these boards. And I believe the build instructions said to add the female jumpers to this bottom board. I don't know if it makes a difference, but it might.
So we will follow those instructions. We will solder those in to set here, and then we'll slot the matching male-male set into those, push this board over it, and then when they're connected, we'll solder it then so that they'll always line up perfectly. All right? Let's do it. All righty. Can you see that? Can you see that? Can you see it? Here we go. Wow, there's some big ass holes right here.
That's what she said.
Yeah. Damn, dude. Hang on. So I'm trying to get out of here, in and out of here as quickly as possible so as to not overheat the switches. But the fact that these holes on the PCB are so humongous, I need to use a lot of solder. But I have faith. Tiling switches seem to be pretty robust. Should be alright. Boom! There she is. Alright. What we're gonna do now is disassemble this whole rigmarole here. And then we're going to put in the, whatchamahoozits. Breaking out all the $5 words today. The pin headers. We'll be fine. See? No problems. Alright, here we go. Switch. 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 Switch to my loo. Do-si-do. Alright. Hang tight. Alright, so I thought I ordered everything correctly, and this is what came with the parts. Some nice pin headers here. I think it goes like this. But this isn't enough for the project. It's not enough pins for the project. I don't think. Hold on. Did I count that wrong? Hang tight. What do we need? We need 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13. 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13. Oh, this is enough. Man. God damn it. You know, it's a miracle that anything works around here. All right, that's fine. So we can do this like you would do it. Okay, so we need to chop these up. We need 1 5 pin. And we need 14. 9 and 5 is 14. So we need 1 5 pin header. And then 3 pins. So we got ourselves a nice razor blade. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Press down with great force.
Then furious anger.
Actually, we don't want to do it on this thing. That would not be advantageous to us in this circumstance. We want to put up a little barrier because these things like to go shooting across the shop. Like so. And I don't like to break them. I like to use the razor blade because oftentimes when you break them, they don't break evenly, and then like one of the pins, the metal of one of the pins is exposed and it's not a, you know, it's liable to fall out and stuff. Same with using side cutters, diagonal cutters. Also called dykes for short. Yeah, see, like I just did there. So, my method sucks too. So, I don't know if there is a good method to do this. Let's try the dykes. Hell with it. Yeah, that's about as good as the razor blade method. Alright. That's what we're doing. Okay, so we have our 5 3/3s. Do the same thing here. Go away, you're fired. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 1, 2, 3. 1, 2, 3. Alright, we're in. Alright, and they say to solder the female ones on the bottom. I'm not sure if it makes a difference, but we will comply.
I will not comply.
Need to set something up here. Get all your screwdrivers out of here. Services are not required for this. Yeah, that ain't gonna work. You know what we can do? If this works. Look at that. We got ourselves a little table. Look at that. That's beautiful. Too bad we get a solder on the other side, dummy. These are shorter than the trimmers. So, if I were to build this again, I think I would put the trimmers on after I did these. Although, this might be okay. If we do that, there we go. Yeah, there we go. This'll work. This'll work just fine. Our solder out. Can you see that? Can you see what I'm doing? There you go. A little bit of light. I can't see what I'm doing. I doubt you can. With the bifocals on and everything. Yeah, baby. You see it? Not really. Kind of blends in. It's camouflaged. It's right here. Alright. I'm going to do the other three, and then we'll check back in with you. Alright, this is where we are at. We got this temp end here. Just so we can line everything up and plan this out. We're really taking our time to do this right. But we have our little pin headers installed. As you can see them there, we cleaned up all the flux residue from the other side of the board. We installed an LED with a socket, 5mm. Fits in there just fine, real nice. We test fit the 9-volt jack and there shouldn't be any problems, but we have to install that after we clamp this little board down. So we'll worry about him later. The build instructions say to do the wiring before you do the male pin headers on the other board, so that's what we're doing. We got our switch all wired up here as per these instructions, and we're just going to go ahead and stick the switch in the enclosure and run some wires and solder the other ends into their spots. We got a couple of jumpers we need to do first though, so we'll do those jumpers and then we'll hook up all these wires and then we'll do the male pin headers and then we'll put it all together like one big guitar Oreo cookie or something like that. I don't know. All right, stay tuned for that. All right, so this is a thing too. We have one of our jacks here. It would be this guy here, the shield connection. It's basically a star ground for the pedal. And we have one long wire for the 9-volt jack. And then we have four other leads going to different spots. And then finally there's going to be one more we need to add, connect to there from the foot switch itself. And he's right here waiting to be hooked up. All right. Moving on. All right. Oh my lord, this thing really is a bear to assemble. Yes, sirree. Kind of looks a little bit like a bird's nest, but shouldn't be too bad. What are we going to do next? We are going to clean up the remainder of the flux. I'm going to socket all of the ICs. I'm going to jam this into here. I think all that's left to connect is the 9 volt positive and negative leads to the 9 volt jack, which is somewhere. And move on to the calibration process. So, yikes, wish me luck. This thing is a bear. Oof. She works! Had a small heart attack. My eyes were welling up. Plugged it in for the first time. Passed signal, but it wasn't doing any effect whatsoever. Took a look at it, quickly figured it out. I had two of the 11 integrated circuits plugged in backwards. Son of a bitch. That's what I'm talking about. All right, we have it in a state where we believe it should be functional. We have our 9-volt jack temped in so we can energize the pedal. And as the build instructions state, it's very important you solder the pin headers in correctly. So we soldered in the female pin headers into the little board, the clock board. And then we took the male-male headers and we socketed them into the female headers. And then we lowered the big board down on top of it. And when we got it to sit where it's going to sit in its final position, then we soldered the pins. Because if we just went and we pushed the pin header all the way down to the board, they would not reach and they would not make connection. And then your shit won't work. All right, so that's very important. Now, because of the way Bucket Brigade chips are manufactured, they need to be calibrated. All right, there's some variance in the manufacturing process and the end result of the chip you get. So each pedal needs to be carefully calibrated. So that's what we're going to do now. All right. So what they say to do is we need a, if we can see this, 8 kilohertz sine wave, 2 volts peak to peak. Alright, we're going to inject that into the pedal, like so.
Wow!
I'm going to energize the pedal. I'm going to turn her on. And over here on our multimeter, not our multimeter, what the heck is this thing called? Oscilloscope. Okay, they say to be sure to ground your probe, so we will comply.
I will not comply.
Ground the probe at the star ground, very good. And they mentioned that Bucket Brigade chips, the output will not be symmetrical. But we want to dial the tremors to have as much headroom, as much even on both sides of the zero reference. All right, so we're going to go over to test point. Let's go over to test point 2 first because it's easier to do this. And we have to do them both anyway. So we're going to hook onto them if we can. There we go. And then we're going to adjust the trimmer to get the largest wave we can on both sides of the zero reference. And as round as possible. See, if you turn it all the way to one way, it gets very asymmetrical. Same if we go the other way. So we want to kind of have it as even as possible on both sides, looking just like that. That looks perfect. And we'll go over to test point 1. Can't lock into them, so this is going to be a little tricky to do. Try and do this without shorting anything out. There we go. Get our little screwdriver in the trimmer. Come on, play ball. There we go. And do the same thing. Right about there. And about there. I think that's about as good as she's going to get. It's a little wavy because it's hard to get a good connection onto the board because we're using this little probe and just kind of sticking it onto the test point. But there we go. That's it. She's calibrated. Let's plug her up to a guitar and see how we did. Okay, the build instructions do say that you can still calibrate the pedal if you do not own an oscilloscope. What you do is you set the trimmers so that the voltage on pin 3 of your bucket brigade chips are half the supply voltage, so about 3.4 volts. And then you just tune it by ear to try and get the least amount of distortion in the signal that you are hearing, which should be between 3.3 and 3.8 volts on pin 3 of your bucket brigades. I would add to that that if you don't own an oscilloscope, then you're probably not at the point in your electronics tinkering career where you should be, you know, trying to assemble one of these projects here. But if you've done, you know, if you've built a bunch of pedals, or if, you know, you work for NASA and you're doing this for fun in your spare time, go for it. You know, it can be done. Don't need it, apparently, but, yeah, you might want it. All right, moving on. Boom! There she is. Oh, you can't see that. Here she is. Phantasma Chorus. By the Tone Priest in the dark. Here we go. Here we go. Looks pretty sweet. Right? That's what I'm talking about right there. Pretty simple controls. We have three switches. The original has four buttons. But the first button just resets all the other ones. So with all the switches down, that's selection one, position one, choice one, whatever it is. Effect one, two, three, four. And we'll play around with that in a minute. But let's plug her up and let's see how she sounds. Yeah. Check it out. It's pretty hot, right? All right, let's do it. Here we go. We'll be right back.
Alrighty, very briefly, we'll twiddle some knobs here, or I guess we're twiddling some switches here. What these switches do is they engage resistors, I believe, into the circuit, and they put resistors in parallel to change resistances, which affect the rate and depth of the effect. I'm going to put a link in the description to a video that was done by the scientific guitarist. He did a great video about the schematic elements of this exact circuit, and he's much more knowledgeable than I am, and you might find it interesting if you're into that kind of thing. Okay, so we have our guitar plugged into the Phantasma chorus, and then we have left and right stereo outputs going direct into the interface. And here we are in Reaper. We have two channels, left and right, just using amplitude amp simulators. We have a bluesy combo and a vintage 1x12 combo. It's the free ones. It's in the free package. You can get those for free. So why don't we start off with dry signal? Alright, so we have all the switches down, so this would be like button number one of the original boss unit. Do this. Hopefully we're in tune. I think we're half a step down. Anyway, so sounds pretty good, but why don't we hard pan the channels hard left and hard right? And let's see what we got here. 100%, 100%. Let's try that again. That sounds pretty nice from where I'm sitting. All right, so that's position one. Oh, we lost you there for a second. For a switch. Second switch. And the third switch. And I think you can play around with combinations. What if we turn this guy all the way, turn that guy down? Yeah, so every combination of having the switches in either the up or down position will change the way the effect sounds. Want to get really squirrely, we'll go into our effect send here. Why don't we add a little reverb and go over here, not reverb, delay, and a little delay. Boom. Let's see what we got. Add a little feedback to that. quick little demo of the pedal. As you can see, it sounds like nothing else, and I don't know. Sounds pretty friggin' sweet to me.
Well, there you go. There you have it. How much fun was that? Probably a lot more fun for you than it was for me. This sucker was definitely a challenge to build. But if you take your time and you do it right, you do it, you know, follow the instructions, be very careful about how you do things. There weren't too many issues putting it together. The biggest problem I had was soldering all those wires into the circuit boards, as you saw. And if I were to do this again, I would have the boards installed into the enclosure, and then I would solder the wires in situ. Can we use that term? The reason I didn't do that is because I put the whole project together, and I pulled the guts out of the enclosure so that I can put the graphic on it. I think if I were to go back and do it again, is I would put the graphic on it, you know, and then install the boards, and then solder all the wires in, if that makes sense. And just be very careful not to scratch this up and screw up our nice-looking Phantasm woman there. Anyway, yeah. Awesome. Came out great. Aion FX, as always, makes fantastic circuit boards for our projects. They're definitely one of our favorites around here. Them and Mad Bean are running neck and neck for first place, with pedal PCB definitely in a close second, or second and a half, third, I guess, technically. Aion FX, like Mad Bean, they have very, very good build instructions. That's one area I think pedal PCB could step up their game a little bit, but they have their forum. But I'm not much of a forum guy. But if you're not afraid of forums, then, you know, all three of them are fantastic companies. But there you go. Blueshift course, based off of the Boss DC-2 Dimension C. All right, everybody. Hope you enjoyed it. I want to thank all my Patreon supporters, subscribers, thumbs-uppers, commenters, and, you know who.
Your mom.
All right, we'll see you real soon with something really cool. Rock on and prosper.
Done!